Welcome to our introduction to Zoom. The first thing you're going to need to do, of course, is get a Zoom account. We recommend that you get the Zoom Pro account from conferzoom.org. You see the address up in the left-hand corner here. Conferzoom.org is a grant-funded program from Palomar that allows us to get Zoom Pro accounts at no cost. All you have to do is go to the Sign Up button right up here, and put in your first, last name, your email address, which should be a .edu email address from Foothill De Anza or Central Services. List the organization, your classification, whether you're administrator, staff, or faculty, your title, and your phone number. Click the blue sign up button at the bottom of the screen, and you will get an email back from them in a very short period of time, very likely a few minutes, with the information allowing you to log into your new Zoom Pro account. Now, you might be wondering, why do I need a Zoom Pro account versus just the free Zoom account? Well, in short, the Zoom Pro account allows you to connect to up to 300 people simultaneously and allows you unlimited connection minutes. The free Zoom account that's not the Zoom Pro limits you to 4 people that you can connect to in 40 minutes. So it is worthwhile to go to conferzoom.org and get your Zoom Pro account at no cost. Now that you have your Zoom Pro account through conferzoom.org, we're going to sign in for the first time. In the upper right-hand corner of the page, you'll see the Sign In button. I click on that, and I put in my district or college email address and my password. If I'm signing in for the first time, I won't see any scheduled meetings on this first screen that I see. You see there's a navigation bar on the left that has meetings, webinars, recordings, profile, and so forth. I'm going to start at the very top here. The profile is just information about you. You can put in information about yourself. You can select a profile picture. That's pretty self-explanatory, so I'll let you explore that on your own. If you have meetings scheduled, they will show up here under Meetings. You can also click this button here to schedule a meeting. We'll get back to that in a second. There is information about webinars. Webinars are how you can offer a webinar and actually charge for it. It's not a feature that we're going to use here a lot, but it might be something you'd want to be aware of. You can also record all of your Zoom meetings, and if you do, under this tab, Recordings, you will see all of your recordings. You can make your recordings go either to the cloud in Zoom and they're stored there, or you can record them on your local computer. The next button here, Settings, has a lot of things in it. We're not going to go over everything in it today, but I'll go over a few basic things for you. This page allows you to configure how your Zoom meetings are set up. You can change these at any time, but you'll want to check these before you set up your first Zoom meeting. For example, host video, if you're setting the meeting up, that would be you, and participants video can be set so that the video is automatically on when the meeting starts, or it's automatically off. You can see it's off in both cases. The audio type for the meeting can be telephone, computer audio, or both. I always recommend that you set your meeting up with both, even if you're only going to use phone audio or computer audio. It simply gives the people at the remote locations more options. It doesn't matter whether you're calling in with telephone or computer audio, because each time you schedule a Zoom meeting, an audio bridge is created online that ties all of this audio together for everyone who's speaking. So it doesn't matter, again, whether they're on computer or a telephone, the audio will go to everyone that's on the conference. When you look down at the next setting here, and I consider this an important one as well, join before host. Notice I have that turned on. That means if I schedule a meeting and I'm late getting to my computer and starting Zoom, the other guests can actually log on and be talking to each other. If I turn that off, no one is allowed to connect to this meeting until I've actually connected. You can also use a personal meeting ID. When you turn this on, every meeting that you schedule will have the same ID number, and that ID number will be related to you and your account. If you leave this button turned off, it generates a unique meeting ID for each individual meeting. You can also require a password for meetings. I have this turned off. Traditionally, I do. If you want to add a password because your meeting contains sensitive information that you don't want others to hear, you can consider password protecting it. There are a lot of other features in the settings. Since this is an introductory video, I'm not going to go over all of them, but I encourage you to explore them and explore some of the other training materials that are available. Okay, now we're going to go back up here and we're going to schedule our first meeting. If I click on the Meetings button on the left, I see a blue button right here that says Schedule a New Meeting. I click on that and it comes up and it asks me for information. You can call it anything you want, discuss new courses, you can enter a full description. You set the date and the time of the meeting here under the When. You set the duration of the meeting, and I recommend you typically set the duration a little longer than the actual meeting. If it's going to be a 1 hour meeting, set it for 1 hour and 15 minutes or 1 hour and 30 minutes. You can end the meeting early, that's no problem, but you don't want Zoom cutting people off as they're having a post-meeting discussion. If it's going to be a regular meeting you're going to do all the time, you can click Reoccurring Meeting. Meeting ID, I mentioned this to you before, can be generated automatically, or you can use your personal meeting ID here, which will always remain the same. You can add a meeting password. You can change many of the basic settings that I already showed you in your settings area for each individual meeting, such as turning video off and on automatically, or allowing both computer audio and telephone audio. You can also enable, and I encourage this, enable Join Before Host. This button down here is primarily of value to counselors and people like that. You can enable a waiting room so people can queue up and wait to speak to you on Zoom. So once I've got this all set up, I can just click Save, and it will save that meeting, and it will give me a meeting summary. What I recommend that you do then is go to the middle of the page over to the right and click the button that says Copy the Invitation. You can copy the invitation, which is all of this connection invite, say Copy Meeting Invitation, boom, it'll copy it. Then you go to an email, you create an email for all the people you want to invite, you paste this information in. They then have the information to be able to connect on telephone, on computer, on tablet, even through Skype. You can use Skype to connect to Zoom. There are a lot of options, and all those options are here inside this meeting invitation. Once you've scheduled your meeting, if you're a first-time user, you need to start your first meeting from inside the web interface. This is because you haven't installed the application yet, or the app, on your local computer. And when I click the button that says Start This Meeting, if you already have the application on your computer, it will open that and connect you. If you don't, it will automatically download the application. Now, I have the application on my computer, so when I click this button, it's just going to open my application. Just for the purpose of this demonstration, I went ahead and dialed into the meeting that I set up from my phone, so you can see that I actually have two participants down here. Let me take a minute and go over what you're seeing on this Zoom interface screen before we actually get started. Over here on the left, you'll notice that there is a microphone and it's moving up and down as I speak. I can click on that and I can mute the microphone. I can unmute the microphone, or if I have an external mic connected, I can click on this arrow next to the microphone and it gives me other options. So if there's a separate microphone that I have connected, it'll show up here. Right next to that is video. Right now my camera is turned off, but I can click the camera. It will turn my camera back on. And again, if I have an external camera connected, like a webcam, it'll show up over here underneath this other arrow. I have an invite button, so while I'm in the meeting, I can actually invite people to join us. Over here is a manage participants button. There's only two participants in here. But if you click this, it will show you over here on the right-hand side. I'm going to have to move the window a little bit so you can see it. There. Over here on the right-hand side, you'll see I'm the host. I'm dialed in from a separate device, so you see my name in there twice, but that's actually two separate connections, as if someone else has joined the meeting. You'll notice it also shows in this participant window the status of my microphone, which is muted on the co-host, but is not muted as the host, and both cameras are muted. Now, if you are the one who set the meeting up, in other words, you're the host, notice down here at the bottom of this participant screen, you can mute everyone or unmute everyone. That's a useful feature if you have people at home, they've got dogs barking in the background, kids making noise, they didn't realize that their microphone was open. If you set the meeting up, you can actually mute them. Moving over to the right again, there is a polling window. You can get information on what they thought of the meeting or what they thought of the presentation. Next to that, this green button that says share, this is a very, very useful button. When you click the green button that says share, it will open up a series of windows showing all the applications that are available to you to share. It will show applications that are open currently on your computer. So the top window here, the top left window, shows sharing the entire desktop. So I would then share everything I'm doing on my computer. You can also share any application that you have open right now and share just that application. So I have Google Chrome open, I have my mail application open, I can share that. I can connect an iPhone or an iPad via a cable and I can share screenshots off of that. Or there is in fact a whiteboard that's built into here. You can click whiteboard and you can share and draw on a whiteboard just like you can in a classroom. Now you'll notice at the very top of the screen here when you want to stop sharing, there's a red button up here that says stop sharing. Next to the sharing button is a chat button. When you click on the chat button, it opens up a chat window showing you all of the people that are in your meeting right now. You can type a message down here at the very bottom to someone in your group, or you can type a message to everyone in your group. So it's a way that people in Zoom can communicate with each other without interrupting the meeting to ask a question. See this little thing that says to everyone? It's a drop-down menu, so I can then select any individual participant and I can send them a chat message without interrupting the meeting and without everyone else in the meeting seeing it. Next to the chat button is a record button. This allows you to record your meeting. Audio, video, chat room, everything goes into the recording. The recording can be saved either on your local computer or in the cloud inside that Zoom window in your browser. By the way, when you do click that record button, the system, the Zoom system, actually announces to all participants that this meeting is being recorded. That's just a nice thing to do so people know they're being recorded when they say certain things. Next to the record button is a closed caption button. This is very important. You can actually assign a participant to type in the captions. You can type the captions yourself, and during the Zoom conference, you can hand off the captions to a different participant or even someone who's remote that's just a professional captionist. That's actually what this third party button where it says copy the API token, that's an identifier for this conference that you would send to a professional captionist who would then be able to insert captions directly into your conference. And finally, on the right-hand side down here, is a button that says breakout rooms. If you have 20 participants, and I've only got one participant in this aside from the host myself, but if you have, say, 20 participants in here, you can actually break them up into virtual online rooms so they are meeting only with each other and not with the entire group. You can then cancel that and bring everyone back together at the end. When your meeting is over, if you've scheduled it for 1 hour, 90 minutes, 2 hours, it will automatically end at the end of that time. However, if your meeting ends early at any given time, you can simply click the button over here that says End Meeting, bottom right of your interface. And when you click that, it says, are you leaving the meeting or do you want to end the meeting for everyone? You can leave the meeting as a host and let everyone else continue to talk, or you can click the End Meeting for All and end the meeting for everyone. That's the end of our introduction to Zoom. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you online.